Good morning. It's great to be with you at St. Paul Lutheran Church and School this morning. We are worshiping in God's house, and we are gathered by Him into this place. As you are gathered in your homes and in different places, God is still in the midst of us, and He is the one who unites us to each other. That's what He talks about in our Old Testament lesson from Isaiah today. As God is the one at work, gathering people from the ends of the earth to come to Himself and receive His gifts and mercy and grace. And so we come to the foot of the cross, to the throne of the Father today, to hear His word, receive those great gifts from Him. Let's pray as we begin our worship today. Heavenly Father, guide our hearts as we come to worship you, fill us with spirit and truth as we are gathered in your name, and remind us daily of all of your promises, which are yes in Jesus. In his name we pray, amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. What do you see when you see a stranger? A threat, a suspect, a foreigner, a misfit? All of our families were from somewhere else sometime in history, and all of us in the kingdom of God were once foreigners as well. We can easily drift into thinking that our churches are primarily or exclusively our own. They're for us and for no one else. Prophet Isaiah declares that strangers and outsiders will not just sort of wander in among us on their own, but that God himself is the one who will bring them in. Jesus' action in healing the daughter of the Canaanite woman indicates clearly that salvation through him is intended for all people. So then, who do you see when you see a stranger? One whom God himself has brought near to you that you might extend some gesture of mercy, some expression of God's welcome to all people? Today's readings challenge our habit of treating strangers and outsiders with suspicion and invite us to find ways to show mercy and welcome of God to everyone, even to those we might think are the least likely people in our community to be welcomed by God. For Jesus came to seek and save the lost, no matter what their background. When the Canaanite woman asked for merciful healing for her daughter, Jesus saw her great faith and granted her request. With all God's people, our Spirit-given faith assures us of forgiveness and frees us to confess our faults and our failures. He's promised to embrace all who repent and cry out for mercy. Regardless of our background, heritage, or station in life, we can approach our Heavenly Father with confidence of His grace and mercy for the sake of His Son, Jesus Christ. Let's confess together. Most merciful God, we confess that in our sinful pride we have neglected to embrace and care for others. We've looked down on people we thought unworthy of our attention or even yours. We failed to act for justice and righteousness as you have commanded. At times we have doubted the extent of your mercy and grace. Forgive us and renew our hearts. Strengthen our faith in the all-availing sacrifice of your Son for us and for all people. Amen. As our Lord Jesus had mercy on the one woman, a foreigner, socially unwelcome, likewise, He has had mercy on us all. Jesus, the Lamb of God, was rejected in our place on the cross and raised from death, assuring us of our Heavenly Father's promised grace. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I forgive you for all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord of all nations, through your Son, you call people of all tribes, nations, and languages into your kingdom of grace. Give us the wisdom and mercy we need to witness to others who might be different than we are. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah chapter 56. Thus says the Lord, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness will be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to Him, to love the name of the Lord and to be His servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, and holds fast my covenant. These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, declares, I will gather yet others to him, besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 11, selected verses. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Now I am speaking to you Gentiles. Inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? As regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake, but as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. For just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience, that he may have mercy on all. This is the word of the Lord.
The earthly ministry of Jesus was, for the most part, in a restricted geographical area. For the 3 years of his public work, he traveled in the area of Judea and Galilee with a singular sojourn through Samaria. But at least on one occasion, he went beyond familiar boundaries north to the district of Tyre and Sidon in what today is Lebanon. There he brought healing for the daughter of a Canaanite woman, a person seen as a Gentile and an inferior by the Jews of his home area. The love of Jesus broke down barriers and reached across divides as people who have been brought out by Jesus, sought out by him. We seek ways to extend his love as the Holy Spirit works in and through us. And so we hear our gospel lesson for today from Matthew chapter 15. Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she's crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of the Lord. We join together in confessing our great faith in our triune God using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being as of one substance with the Father by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The sermon text for us today is our gospel lesson in Matthew chapter 15. At verse 21, Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." That's our text. So it's a road trip. Jesus takes his disciples to a place that they very well may not have ever been before, way to the north of Israel, over to the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, and into a land that that was a Gentile, and not only Gentile, but Canaanite territory. These are more ancient enemies of Israel than the Samaritans. But it's a very interesting place. I don't know so much about Sidon, but both Tyre and Sidon are among the oldest continuously inhabited cities in the world. They were both founded about 3,000 years before Christ. And sometimes there were a lot of people there, sometimes only a few, but continuously inhabited for 5,000 years. Think of that. Tyre is very interesting. It was such a great naval power there on the coast that for a period of time, the Mediterranean Sea was called the Tyrian Sea. Tyre is where a lot of the shellfish that the purple dye came from was harvested. And so a very wealthy area because of that. Tyre was considered to be impregnable. The city had a fortress, a big city and walls and all that on the shore. But it also had an island and a city on the island, and that was fortified with big stone walls. And then there was a narrow causeway to get from the shore to the island that meant that it couldn't be attacked very well by sea because of their powerful navy, and it couldn't be attacked on land because you'd have to come across just a few at a time to assault them. So Tyre was quite a famous place until about 332 or so BC, when Alexander the Great came along and conquered it. And the Jewish people must have felt really good about this, because it was in fulfillment of prophecy in the Old Testament that Tyre would be leveled. And nobody could see how that could ever have happened. But he came along, Alexander, and conquered the city on the shore. And then he tore that city down to the ground and threw it into the sea, as God had foretold, and used it to build a giant peninsula out to the island so that his army could move across. And historians say that the siege engines that he built were the largest any army had ever built and moved to conquer the city of Tyre. So quite an interesting place for the disciples to come. It was at times an ally of Israel. Hiram, the king of Tyre, had provided beams for the temple. But it was always, since Israel came into the land after the Exodus, after they left Egypt, ever since that time, it was an enemy of, it was Canaanite, it was the land that they could not conquer. They were foreign. So now, Jesus and his disciples go up into that area, and they meet this woman coming to them, a Canaanite woman, and she would have been so very different. This is what I want to emphasize in our text. When we read these stories, everybody seems the same. But to the people who participated in these stories, they did not all seem the same. She would have dressed very differently from them. In our Bible study, Bible story pictures, the Sunday school drawings and that sort of thing, we would just say, well, it's Middle Eastern clothing. But there would have been distinctive clothing of the Canaanites and the Jews, and their wives and mothers would not have looked like this woman. This woman would have smelled different from them and from their families, the foods that she ate, the things that were cooked in her house, the livestock that they kept were very different. The shellfish, the whole harvesting of the purple dye, was a very strong smell. So anyone who lived around Tyre would have maybe had a whiff of that as well. She was different in that way. Neither of those things are mentioned in Scripture, but they would have been differences. But the item that is so often appears in our text here is her voice. She cries out, it says. And how would you hear that cry? You know, again, we look at those stories and we hear them in voices that we're familiar with. But when the disciples heard this woman, they did not just hear what she said. They heard the way that she said it. They heard her accent. Her accent gave her away, and her accent made her seem like an enemy, like an alien, like a foreigner, like someone you can't trust. You could tell right away, as you do yourself when you talk to somebody, you could tell, she's not from around here, right? We think accents are cute, endearing. Mostly when you think of accents, you think of movie characters Or if you happen to go to McDonald's and you walk in and the person behind the counter speaks with a British accent, oh, that's really fascinating, isn't it? And you want to say, so where are you from? How long have you been in this country? And it's nice. Or if you call a help center, you call a helpline, and the person who answers sounds Australian, well, that's very pleasant, isn't it? You kind of want to know more about them. On the other hand, sometimes accents are more difficult for us, the things that we don't like. So here's an accent of somebody who we'd say, why are so many of these people moving into our area? And I recognize that accent, I don't like it. Or some of you have commented to me, many people come from elsewhere to the United States to go to medical school. And so many medical professionals around us have a foreign accent, an Indian or Pakistani accent. And it troubles you that you can't understand your doctor as well as you would like. Some of you, that bothers. Sometimes an accent, though this seems a little old-fashioned, sometimes an accent also seems to us to put distance between us. It's not always quaint or fascinating or cute. 100 years ago, just right about exactly 100 years ago, my grandfather said, there will be no more German spoken in this house, because it was during World War I. It was at the tail end of the Spanish flu, incidentally, a greater pandemic than this one. And in the middle of World War I, to speak like a German in any way made you an enemy, made you a suspect. My father was born 6 years later in 1926, and his entire life, he only knew that his name was Jim Neuendorf, not Neuendorf. And he never learned a word of German, because that would have seemed disloyal. Yes, accents sometimes are problematic for us. Accents sometimes say things that we, more than what we intend to say. Maybe you don't think that you would discriminate based on an accent. And yet, there are times when you hear someone's accent or their grammar and you are gauging their intelligence or their level of education. I confess, if you say to me, I seen you there, I cringe and I work at not making unfortunate judgments because of things like that. It's built into us, isn't it? Here's another question that maybe is more helpful. These disciples judged this woman on her accent, on the way that she spoke, and they knew who she was. She looked at them and they had an accent and she knew who they were, and that they seemed above her. But I wonder, what's your accent? Have you ever thought about that? If you appeared in this story, how would you sound? Of course, you would say, I don't have an accent. I'm from the Midwest, and so that's where we have no accent. This is accentless English, right? It's perfect. Except when I go to Ohio, people say, oh, are you from Michigan? When I lived in Indiana, when I would go home to Indiana, people would ask, oh, you must be from Michigan. And my mother often said, Michigan, as a teasing thing. She thought it sounded like that when we said Michigan. Michigan? And if I went to Wisconsin, people would say, oh, you're from Michigan. How do they know that? I had a friend who was from Ontario who would tease me about cutting the lawn. Well, what's wrong with cutting the lawn? Or no, cutting the grass, she said. I suppose you have to cut the grass. And I said, is it about time for me to mow the lawn? Now, we notice accents, but we often don't see that we ourselves have an accent, because of course everyone around us speaks correctly. We grew up thinking that way about Bible stories like this too. Of course, everyone in the Bible story speaks like us, because it's read here in our church by people who live near us, and we always hear the Word of God in our own voices, in a sense, in our own language. But if you were to appear there and ask Jesus for help, how would you sound to those disciples? How would they judge you? You would be even more alien than this Canaanite woman. You would be even more strange in your clothing and with your smell. She at least had a similar dialect or a language that they could understand one another if they spoke Greek or Aramaic. How primitive you would have sounded coming to Jesus and asking for help in your barbarian tongue. Help, help, or maybe help, help, or some other variation on how you might say that. It would have all sounded like barking to them. Instead of the Kyrie Boethe that she spoke, every word in this story, every word spoken in this story by the disciples, by the woman, by the people around, would sound alien, primitive, barbaric, and like an enemy to God. As God is listening, as people come to Jesus with their pleading, with their prayers, they would sound like growling animals, yelping hyenas, barking dogs with their nonsensical words, until we come to the end of this story at verse 28 and we encounter these words: O Ginai, O woman, Megale su pistis, Megale su he pistis, how great is your faith. Genetheton, genethetos soi hostales, be it to you as you desire. When you are that person in deep need, when you are that person who is separated and alien and foreign and considered an enemy, when you're far away and you cry out in the best way that you can for help, and you struggle to find words to phrase your prayers, nothing sounds grand enough. And when you recognize how you must sound to God, and then when you hear God's voice, the voice of Jesus, O woman, O man, how great is your faith. May it be to you as you wish. In every language, in every dialect, with every local flavor, the words of Jesus have the accent of grace. The words of Jesus have the sound of salvation. The words of Jesus have this resonance of redemption, of rescue, of resurrection. The words of Jesus have this aura of adoption, this flavor of forgiveness, the sound of Jesus' voice. And whenever we read his words in the Gospels, Jesus' voice sounds like the accent of grace. Do you feel like you belong here because everybody talks like you? You feel like you belong in your church or your community because we all have the same language, the same accent? You don't belong here. You don't belong in this church. You don't belong in United States of America. You don't belong on this earth. Your accent, your voice, your language, you belong in heaven. where they speak your language. You belong in God's house, where they speak words of grace and forgiveness and life forever and ever. Nothing sounds like that. Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Join our hearts and our voices together in prayer today. Father, we're foreigners who were far off, and you called us to yourself. We love your name, we desire to be your servants. Today, we worship you and we keep your Sabbath. We're daily holding fast to your covenant promises that have found and will find their fulfillment in your Son, Jesus. Guide us today as we come to your holy mountain, joyful in your house of prayer. And when we are alone, Lord, remind us that you gather us with others who also rejoice in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, our lives clearly show our disobedience to you and your commands. And yet out of your great love, you show us mercy. Work in us new hearts that are no longer selfish. Work in us new hearts that show mercy to others. We all sin and fall short of your glory. So help us to remember that this is true of our brothers and sisters in Christ as well. And fill us with forgiving hearts that lift up those who stumble and restore those who fall. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, lead us to keep justice and do righteousness as we wait for the salvation that you bring and as we wait for your righteousness to be revealed. Lead your church to be a light that shines the righteousness of your truth, that we would proclaim it clearly and boldly. Use your church as the place where true justice is found as we speak up for the oppressed and help the underserved. That all in our community would hear and come to your throne of grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we rejoice that you have brought Melissa Needham and Josh Ehrman together in marriage this weekend. Fill them as husband and wife with the self-sacrificial love that you have shown to us. We also thank you as John and Claudia Bunenberg celebrate their 10 years of marriage. Lord, work in their lives and in all marriages that husbands and wives would live in faithfulness to each other and to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, like the Canaanite woman, we pray that you would have mercy on us and have mercy on the people that we pray for today. Hear the cry of our hearts for those who need healing. We continue to pray for little ones, Waylon and Hadley. We pray for George, Branson, Laura, Anne, and Marge. We ask that you would continue to watch over the recovery of Sally, Sharon, and Liz. And we pray for those with cancer, Jeremiah, Don, Nola, Jerry, Greg, Tom, Ed, and Kathy. Lord, comfort them with your promises and heal them according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we come to you in grief over the death of our sister in Christ, Deb Gustitis. We thank you for calling her as your child, and we're grateful that she rests with you even as we grieve with Paul and the rest of her family. Fill us all with the hope you proclaim in Jesus' resurrection, that because he lives, Deb and we will live also. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, you are the giver of all that is good. So mercifully hear the prayers of your people today and give us your grace that we would faithfully endure the changes and chances of this life, that we would patiently wait for the day when Jesus comes to bring completion to all things. We come to you through his name and also praying as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Good morning, St. Paul. I am Rachel Potts. I'm the Director of Communications here at St. Paul Church. And this morning, I am joined by Clara Torque. And Clara is responsible for a lot of what happens with the group called ACTS at St. Paul. So, Clara, could you tell us a little bit about yourself first?
Hi, I'm a retired teacher from St. Paul. I taught in Lutheran schools for 43 years, and I have a love of sewing. And so I decided that we needed a group of sewers at St. Paul, and we do have one now.
That's wonderful. And Claire, your group is called ACTS. What does that stand for?
ACTS stands for Actively Caring Through Sharing. It's basically our way of sharing our sewing abilities that God has given us with others.
Wonderful. Okay. And what kinds of things do you make at ACTS?
Well, I'm going to combine making and who we give it to, because we do a wide variety of things. We started making quilts for shut-ins at the church, and that has extended also to quilts for VA hospital. During COVID, we've all been busy in our own homes making masks and surgical caps for various members and organizations. Our We've done little projects such as dresses for girls in Africa, tote bags for homeless, neck coolers for most, but our big thing that we just somehow love, and who can't, it's the baby stuff. We do bibs, burp cloths, receiving blankets, quilts, isolate sheets, and they go to a variety of places such as Family Life Services, Arbor Women, Hope Clinic, St. Joe's NICU, and Luke Project 52.
Oh, that's wonderful. So a lot of people are being blessed by the work that you're doing.
Oh, we hope so.
That's fantastic. Clara, how often do you get together with your, well, let me ask you that. Are you getting together in person now again?
Actually, we started this last week. We meet on the second Saturday of the month. We meet at the Fine Arts Room in the school. We only meet from 9 a.m. to about 2 or 3 p.m. We work on various projects, and some people just work during that time period, and others, like myself, I bring stuff home, and because I'm now retired, I have the time to put forth more time into my sewing. So we work on projects as we need, and we just love it.
That's wonderful. So you may start a project one week and continue on for a couple more months if needed?
Oh, yes, depending on the project. Some are shorter, some are smaller, some we don't need as many items, but we've done a wide variety. In fact, right now we're finishing up VA quilts, and I think we have, somebody did a tally this last week and thought it was around 24 quilts for VA hospital.
Oh, that's fantastic. Oh my goodness. Now, Claire, if somebody's interested in coming and joining you, couple questions. One would be about the skill level needed and about equipment.
Basically, we each have our own sewing machine. We have to bring it in. We have very little space at the school. As Bob Burgess and I have talked, if you give a quilter or a sewer a cupboard, a shelf, we take three or four. And so we have had to maintain our distance from the school, so we carry everything in. Skill level, as long as you can sew a straight seam on your sewing machine, you know how to run your sewing machine. We can do a little troubleshooting, but that's not our expertise. We'll go to the internet instead to find out what's going on. But we can help you along with learning how to put those straight seams into a simple project. And the projects behind me here are very simple.
Those are beautiful.
But, and that's just an idea of what we kind of do.
Okay, great. How many people do you have typically on a Saturday?
We go anywhere from three up to, we've had probably six or seven.
Okay.
So not everybody makes it every time. It's kind of a come and do as you can. Some people hardly ever come, but they offer projects. They do things on their own at home. And so it's kind of like do as you can.
Okay. So no long-term commitment needed.
No. It's if it's interesting to you and you want to do it, you're welcome to do it. Some people bow out of certain projects because it's just not their thing.
Okay. Claire, would you, if someone was quarantining at home for health reasons or otherwise, would they be invited to work on the same project that you're doing and perhaps contribute that way?
Oh, most definitely. In fact, we met last Saturday, but most of our members chose to stay home.
Okay.
They know what we're doing. We have gotten together at the very beginning of COVID. We got together to share supplies, and then we dispersed within 10 minutes. You know, so we try to make sure people have what they need. So we help out as much as we can.
Wonderful.
If people want to do it, we want to be there for them to be able to contribute.
That's great. Now, if somebody has watched this and said, hey, I am so excited, I want to sign up, where can they, who do they need to get in touch with?
They need to get in touch with me.
Okay.
I'm in the directory. I hit my phone number and my email address are fine. And I can walk you through whatever you need and whatever your questions are.
Okay, fantastic. Great. Well, thank you so much, Claire, for joining me this morning, and God's blessings to you. May I pray for Axe and you quickly before we go?
Oh, please.
Okay, wonderful. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the work of Clara and the other women at St. Paul that are working with the ACTS organization to help make things with their hands, Lord, that then go out and bless the community of Ann Arbor and the world, Lord. They're reaching far corners of the earth. When their hands are working, Lord, we know that it's your hands working, and you're sharing the gifts that you've given them and their skills with people all over. Lord, please continue to bless these women, help their numbers to grow so that they can do all the projects that their hearts desire to do for you, Heavenly Father. Keep all of them safe and healthy in these days ahead, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. A thousand songs are not enough to say how great you are. The glories of your majesty, the triumphs of your love. Awake my soul to sing the glories of my God and King. Arise and praise the one worthy of the songs of a thousand tongues. Power of all our sin, you set the captive free. You make the broken heart rejoice, new life the dead receive. Awake my soul to sing the glory.
Is that races through the Apostles' Creed quickly. We each thought it was ourselves. Okay. Prayers.
Take one.
And
When the Canaanite woman asked for merciful healing for her daughter, Jesus saw her great faith and he granted her request. With all God's people, our spirit-given faith assures us.
Start over?
Yeah. Well, yeah. We'll just...